that case, we move on. The previous paper was about data and your loss. Here we are gonna go back to CTC loss, but then work on the design of our convolutional neural network or our neural network in general. This is an engineering paper, so there is gonna be a lot of trial and error going on so that in the end you get a better performance in terms of your word error rate. So you're gonna do a lot of experimentation. So this is not magic that they come up with this architecture. They put a lot of time and GPU hours to produce these results and beat the state of the art. You take your spectrogram, you do convolution, batch, non-ReLU with a kernel width of 11 and these many filters, 256. So that's the first convolution. The next ones are gonna be a bunch of residual blocks. So one residual block, you repeat that B times, and then the last residual block. The first one is prolog. Then you're gonna introduce an epilog for your convolution. There is gonna be another convolution there. Another convolution, a one by one convolution that's gonna give you your vocabulary size, and then a CTC. You see the architecture is just feed forward. There is no encoder decoder going on. And then you do a lot of work on your CTC loss and you just write it down. What is this block doing? It's gonna be 1D convolution, batch norm, ReLU, dropout. And then you want to add a residual connection to the last guy. This one you are repeating R times. But after repeating this stuff R times, the dimensions are gonna get messed up. The dimension, the number of channels that you have. So you're gonna fix the dimension by a one by one convolution. You do batch norm and then you add the input to the output here and then you continue. This is ResNet type neural network. There is a very good architecture that we cover in part one of the course, and that is about dense nets. This is a combination of the two. This is a combination of dense nets and ResNets, and they're calling it dense residual. So for dense net, you're gonna take these outputs from the previous layers. These are coming from, I don't know, the first layer and then the second layer and so on. And then let's say you're here. Now you want to combine them. For dense net, you're gonna concatenate and then multiply by a bunch of weights. Here, you're just gonna add them together. Okay, perfect. In terms of the details of the architecture, you have one block of your prolog, and then you have B1, B2, B3, B4, B5. These are your B blocks. And then you're gonna have a conv2 here. And these are all one-dimensional convolutions. And then you do a conv3, a conv4, and then you're gonna output the number of the size of your vocabulary. And then you play around with your dropout ratio. And then the number of sub-blocks is this R that you're seeing here, or when you're repeating R times. And that's hence the name. Whenever you see Jasper B times R, you're gonna have B blocks and R sub-blocks. Okay, perfect. You wrote down an architecture, you gave it some data, you write down your loss function, you start training, and you're gonna use ADAM, and then it's not converging. So you did everything that you could, but then it's not converging as you expected. One might say, how about changing our optimization scheme? So Novograd is very similar to ADAM, but ADAM is doing its adaptive operations per each single weight that you have. So each weight in your training, in your neural network is gonna have its own adaptive rate. Maybe that's not a good idea. Maybe it's a better idea to combine a bunch of weights and then have a common adaptive rate for those subset of weights. So how are we gonna do it? We know that the adaptivity in ADAM is coming from the gradients of our weights, the gradient of your loss with respect to the weight. For ADAM, you are just squaring this for every single weight. Basically, the derivative of your loss with respect to every single weight, you just square it, and that's gonna give you your adaptivity per every weight. But now we are putting the weights in a layer in one vector, and then have a common adaptive rate for that layer. So it's gonna be shared. It's gonna be a shared learning rate. And that's coming from the L2 norm of your gradient. So now your gradient is a vector, you can compute its norm. Previously, per each single weight, that's just a scalar, and you're taking that scalar and squaring it. But now this is a vector. And then the adaptivity comes from taking the square root of this VTL that you just computed here. And this is just to give you the momentum. So the rest of it is very similar to a usual Adam optimizer. And at the same time, you can add some weight decay. So weight decay is equivalent to having the L2 norm or penalizing the L2 norm of your weight. You can implement it in terms of weight decay, because as you take the derivative of the L2 norm of a weight, you're going to get this term, because that's going to cancel out. The 2 is going to cancel out, and so on. And then you just update it. Now that you have a vector, it's giving you a direction to go. You just go in that direction, you take a step, and now you're going downhill. So the only change is you have an adaptive learning rate per each layer, not per each weight. Okay, that's going to help stabilize the training, because this is a very deep model. If you think about it, it's B times R is the depth of the model plus all of these convolutions. Some of these papers, let's compare the performance on a speech, on Libri speech, in terms of word error rate. All of these, some of them are end-to-end training, some of them are not. So you have to split the training into two parts. But the ones that are end-to-end, Deep Speech 2, we covered. The other ones, we didn't have time to cover. And this one is the previous paper, Listen, Attend, and Spell, plus the data augmentation technique. Each one of these guys are using a different type of a language model for decoding. 5-gram is the simplest language model that you can come up with. Then there is LSTM, convolution language models, and RNNs. But we know that these days we have better language models. We covered them, like Transformer XL. And they're going to help this model perform the best, okay, on all of these different cases. You can do Wall Street Journal, and a better language model is helping. You can do Hop 5, and then you can have different language models. These are end-to-end. They're using neural network, end-to-end training. And whenever you see, for instance, 10 by 5, it corresponds to Jasper B by R. So you have B blocks, R sub-blocks. And the other thing that you're seeing here is DR, and that stands for dense residual. So that's the architecture that they're using for this data set and this other data set here. The question is, visually speaking, what is the effect of your language model? If you use a better language model, the perplexity is going to go down. For instance, this could be your 5-gram language model, this could be your RNN, and this could be the Transformer XL. And they're giving you better and better perplexity. So for perplexity, the lower is better. And then your word error rate is highly correlated with the language model that you're using. The better your language model, the less mistakes you're going to make. And how can you compare residual with dense residual, with dense net versus dense R net, residual net, while being fair? So this is trying to be fair for them to have the same number of parameters on two different data sets. And you can see that the dense residual, which is this architecture here, is doing the best, but these numbers are very close to each other. Here you are seeing most of the performance gain. Any questions?
I had a quick question.
Sure.
In the table on the far left, it seems that the LAS model is performing the best. Am I interpreting that correctly? Even though it doesn't have data for everything.
So you mean this LAS model?
Yeah, the one we covered earlier.
So yes, they are not reporting these numbers. So we don't know what those numbers are. But yes, you're right here. It's giving you 2.5 here and then 5.8 here. But this is using a different type of framework,
mm-hmm.
a different type of a loss function, and then at the same time doing data augmentation.
Is this, I don't know if we'll talk about this later, but I mean, will we see that these encoder-decoder type architectures outperform the type of architecture that we're considering here that uses the CTC loss?
Not necessarily. So they usually compete against each other. So these are two different frameworks that they compete against each other. Maybe the performance gain is because of the augmentation.
Okay.
But yes, I want you to know both of them. I don't want you to stay in your comfort zone, because this is easy. This we covered and for our text, but I wanted you guys to know that there is a different way of writing your loss function. And you're gonna hear about that a lot. So I wanted you guys to know what is CTC if you read it somewhere, okay? And I think both of them are useful. Any other questions?